Hi, I'm Chrissy, and I teach astronomy at the museum, and I'm super excited to help you understand what's so incredible about these new images from the James Webb Space Telescope. For almost my entire adult life, I have been waiting for this telescope to be taking incredible images, looking deep, deep, deep into our universe. Even the closest thing to us in space, the moon, is 240,000 miles away. So we measure using the speed of light. A light year is the distance that light travels, moving at the speed of light, in 1 year. So here we have this deep field image. You'll see in the forefront of this image a whole bunch of galaxies all together, and those galaxies are about 4.6 billion light years away. The light from those galaxies left that point in space 4.6 billion years ago and has been traveling ever since then. And now, just now, those photons are hitting the James Webb Space Telescope's array. The telescope is not just looking back in distance, we are actually looking back in time. Almost everything we're seeing in this image is a galaxy. You will see a couple of stars with the spikes coming up. Those, they're called diffraction spikes. All of these other objects you see besides those few stars are galaxies. Each one of those contain hundreds of millions of individual stars. Each of them are incredibly far apart and they're huge. So as we're looking at this, the scale is kind of hard to imagine. Although at the forefront we have this galactic cluster, we can also see all kinds of other stuff behind it. The mass this galactic cluster has is enough to actually warp the space-time around it, bending the light from these distant galaxies. And that's why you see these like weird curved lights. We need to see visible light with our eyes to detect anything. But unfortunately, so much of the light in the universe is not in this tiny part of the spectrum. And so we use instruments that look at other parts of that spectrum. There's ultraviolet radiation and X-ray radiation and gamma radiation, but also there's infrared radiation and radio waves. All of this make up the electromagnetic spectrum. What James Webb does better than any telescope we've ever had is it is looking at these infrared wavelengths, and it's looking at a much wider band of infrared than the Hubble Space Telescope can. The reason we want to focus on infrared is because of redshift. As objects move towards you, those wavelengths tend to get a little more closer jammed together and it shifts towards the blue. And when things are moving away from us, they shift towards the red. Our universe is expanding, and therefore everything in the universe pretty much is moving away from us. So we need to be looking not just at the visible wavelengths, but things that are shifted more towards the red. And that's why the Hubble Space Telescope had infrared cameras. And so we came up with even better infrared cameras that are on the James Webb Space Telescope that help us see objects that are moving away from us, and therefore everything in their spectra is shifted towards the red.
Hello everyone, my name is Rocío Guima and I'm an astronomer. I'm a postdoc at the UC Santa Barbara and the Cal Institute for Theoretical Physics. In this image we have WASP 96P. It's an exoplanet, so it's a planet that is orbiting a star outside of our solar system. It's a giant gas exoplanet, and its atmosphere is very puffy. So don't get too excited about moving to WASP 96P. This exoplanet is very, very close to the star. It's extremely hot. Now with James Webb, we can get the light that is going through the atmosphere of that exoplanet and study what that light is telling us about the composition of the atmosphere. This atmosphere has water in it. This is not liquid water. It's just in form of gas. This is the first time that we can get such a precise and detailed spectra. This has to do with two main topics. There are a lot of things going on, but two main things. One is that James Webb is in space, so we don't need to care about the atmosphere of the Earth interfering with our observations. And the second thing is that the primary mirror, that is a thing that looks like a honeycomb, is 6.5 meters long, so it's huge. So we are getting a lot more data. So we're talking about a telescope that has a primary mirror of 6.5 meters, and then it has a sun shield to protect it from the sun of the size of a tennis court. So what the scientists and the engineers came up with was to fold both the mirror and the sun shield to put it inside the rocket, and then once in space it will deploy, it will span. This process took around 2 weeks and it was a very nerve-wracking process. Luckily nothing failed, everything worked perfectly, and we have James Webb in the position and in the form that we wanted. Hubble was orbiting the Earth. James Webb is going to be orbiting the Sun together with Earth, and it's going to be at the same relative position to Earth and the Moon. This is extremely important. James Webb doesn't receive any direct sunlight. These instruments have to be very cool in order to function well. James Webb measures in the infrared. It's basically measuring heat that is coming from an object. This is where heat radiation is in the spectrum. So if the instrument starts to get hot, then the instrument will be measuring its own heat. So we need the instruments to be extremely cold. So I'm personally extremely excited about James Webb. With my collaborators, we're waiting for images to come from James Webb. I'm extremely excited about this data. I cannot wait for it to arrive and start analyzing and start discovering new things about these objects.
My name's Chuck, and I'm the outreach coordinator for the Astronomical Unit, and we do public outreach, bringing telescopes out for the public to show them astronomy. Here at the museum, on the second Saturday of every month, we have a free public star party, and we often get questions about cosmology, about the origin of the universe and the fate of the universe. But James Webb is not only going to answer a lot of questions that people have about cosmology and the universe, but it's going to generate a bunch of new questions. And this is an object called a planetary nebula, which is where a low-mass star like our Sun basically burps itself to death and throws off its outer layers. And the core collapses to form a white dwarf, giving off ultraviolet light, making the layers it barfed off fluoresce like in a neon light. Looking at pictures of objects like this, of course, it's a very pretty picture and people enjoy that, but it's more than just a pretty picture. The scientific data that comes from these different wavelengths, there's just an amazing amount of information that can be extracted. And the really, really cool thing is these objects often show a lot of symmetry, bilateral symmetry, like butterflies and things. We've suspected that in many cases it's due to double stars, you know, that are orbiting. In this image, you can actually see that there's a nice tight binary pair in the center. And there are a pair of images that were released, and these are showing you the different temperature levels of the different layers of this star as it pulsated and poofed off successive layers of its atmosphere as it was reaching the end of its life. The James Webb Telescope is actually a huge consortium, a huge cooperation between groups all around the world. The European Space Agency, the Canadian Space Agency, NASA, to design and produce the instruments that have gone up into it and to analyze the data, of course. That's going to be spread out all over the world. And just to talk to it, we need an array of deep space network antennas all around the world so that as the Earth rotates, we can continuously get data from the James Webb Space Telescope.
Wow, I don't know about your day, but my day has been so exciting. Looking at these images is the culmination of literally decades of work by thousands of people all over the world. People have dedicated their entire careers and lives for putting together this incredible project that all together represents the whole world, achieving things we've never achieved before and learning things we've never learned, and now giving us the opportunity to ask questions we didn't even know we needed to ask.